Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. I'm gonna be Awesome. You guys, guys are too, right? So we know where this is. Let's sing these kids happy birthday, all right? And we gotta, how about this, we gotta feed the people up here in the praise team, how about a round of applause for us? We got Rob's grab, right? Yeah, we got a lot of you guys, so, with the up, Mark, and we got, we saw Joe working on too, so. All right, let's listen to a happy birthday song for these guys, all right?
I'm gonna go get I am a friend of God. That you are my glory.
Everybody loves Tony. This is Mark, a great
I'm going to go to the next one. You can't do it. Bales, and we sell those bales to 13 to three or four world countries, poorer countries buy them for 19 cents a pound. That's like 20. Only from
we found a little extra somewhere, but
at any rate, I've been praying and I've been announcing on the radio that we need more clothes, people donating more clothes, and I'll talk to you more about that later on. But I want to tell you what happened today. So Mark, you can help me. Where did we go today?
We went to a company called Cintas, and if you heard of Cintas, their commercial is Cintas, the uniform people, right? And we met them at a party a few weeks ago before Christmas. Never had this contact before, didn't know any of the people. We're there, start to talk a little bit. Well, we got this idea, we have all these clothes, and they either get out of style their uniforms, right? And so maybe the dealership or the maintenance place that buys the uniforms doesn't want gray anymore, now they want brown, right? And now we got all these gray uniforms we don't know what to do with, right? So what does Cintas do with those? They throw them away, right? Throw them in the dumpster. And that's.
When we pulled up, we pulled up to their factory, 40,000 square feet of factory. It was amazing.
When we went there,
what did we see there in the back?
We went to the back. The park was a little scarce there, so we weren't quite sure where to park. But when we pulled into the back, just dumpsters filled with clothes that are just going out. Yeah, they're just right. That's what the kind of the corporate way a lot of companies do things, right? We're in America, we waste more than we most countries ever get, and we waste. And so that's just what they do. And they're not the only ones. It's not carpet on them for anything. That's the way most companies do. Even restaurants, right? I don't want to give our food or access to the store away. It's easier than a dumpster. So we went back there and literally saw just dumpsters. Clothes waiting to be taken to a dump where somebody could use those, so they could make money on those. Maybe on some of them there's really nothing wrong. Maybe some of the button missing or needs a little turmoil. Many are just out of style. They're not the material that company wants anymore, or the color, or the fit. So
yeah, and you know this.
trying to. No idea what Grace Centers was, the magnitude, and what a well of machine this is, and all the aspects that we cover. And so we were the same. I'm telling you, when we got there, I thought it was going to make it like a big laundry mat. That's kind of what I thought. In this place, there are clothes, floor to ceiling. When you're talking and you're sitting there, there's clothes, racks of clothes being processed, going over your head, they're going around you. It's a huge, huge building. And yeah, that's what they've committed to. They've committed to giving us all that access and all that stuff that they're throwing. They're going to give it to us to sell in the thrift stores or to make bales. And with the thrift stores bringing in, you know, 30 to 40% of our budget every year, that is a blessing. That's, if you're in the thrift store part of things, that is, it's a miracle. It truly is.
And they brought in, their executives
here. They're from
Ohio, who came down to, Mark and I, and
Eric was with us from the thrift stores.
Yeah. And I got to tell him all some of our stories. You know, I tell those stories
every now and then.
And so I was sitting there with the executive telling the Guinea story, stories you've heard thousands of times about God's miracle. And I get to crying. That's how old I am. I'm crying with these executives sitting in the boardroom with me telling the stories. It was just a God moment today. And a miracle of God.
We took a couple pictures out there too. On Sunday, you'll see them in the slideshow. When you see them, you'll get that. That's the group. But make no mistake, too. I know Pastor in the moment was emotional crying, but there was five or six other people. Here too, so you know, it's we're not alone in this, right? This is all of us together, right? And to have somebody jump into the mix and say, we're passionate about it, we want to help you out, that's what we pray for. And it was
praising,
awesome.
Praising God,
yeah,
in the boardroom of a secular company.
It is.
I'm And the first day God does this, and
so on and so forth. And immediately what people begin to do, as soon as they begin to read Genesis chapter 1, or you hear people talking about it, thinking about it, the question right away is, well, how long did it really take? I know it's been 7 days, but how long was it? Or how did he do it? How long did it take? Now listen, the Bible does not really set out to answer the question of how long it took. Now, of course, it took 7 days, as we read the scripture. But it doesn't set out to answer how questions. Genesis chapter 1 sets out to answer why questions. Not how he created it, but why he created it. So imagine if somebody, you know, I give you an iPhone. I say, hey, look, check this out. I don't know if you guys can see that. Let's say I give you an iPhone. Right? I give it to you, you don't immediately go, oh, how long did it take to make it? Well, that's weird. How did they make it? I'd say, who cares? What difference does it make how long it took? The question is, what's it for? Why? What's the purpose of it? I want to use it. I want to use it for what it was intended for. So why questions are much more important than how. Now, only knowing what something is created for, can you know its purpose, right? So, right off the bat, when it says in the beginning, God, if you were to like find this phone laying on the street somewhere, you would immediately gather that somebody designed it. Somebody must have made it on purpose. That, you know, you don't find archaeologists digging up rocks that look like an iPhone, right? That are very intricate and do all kinds of types of things that an iPhone can do. So the very fact that God created, it's very obvious that he created us and designed us for a purpose. And based upon whether or not something, what its purpose is, determines whether it's good or bad. Right? So, if I were to take this phone, I've been on another planet or something, and you hand it to me, and I said, oh my gosh, what an incredible hammer this is. And I start to like hammer nails into the wall. I start to, and you'd be like, and it broke. Right? I'm like hammering something, and it breaks. And I say, that thing's terrible. Maybe it's a terrible hammer. Well, what would you say? You say, well, it's not a hammer, stupid. It's not a hammer. You're using it for something that it was not intended for. It's an incredible phone. It's the best phone. You guys can catch that. But the very fact that something is created and has a purpose means that it must have, that is what determines on whether something is good or bad. You understand what I'm saying here? So, when something has a purpose, well, if I were to say it like this, if something has no purpose, what is that? What do we call something with no purpose? It's useless, exactly. It's trash. And then, so in our culture, and in our country, and in our lives, we've done virtually everything we can possibly do to keep God out of my life, out of my family, out of my society, and then we wonder why we're so depressed. Well, why is that? Well, because when something has no purpose, it's trash. It's useless. And many of us have been trying to live our lives like there is no God, like we get to determine what makes us good or bad. But the very fact that God created us with a purpose means we don't get to determine whether or not what we decide is good or bad. That means the only way that we can determine that is to know what is my purpose. If you're depressed, you're frustrated with life, if you're wondering what in the world I'm doing here, or wondering, as I mentioned to you, that you know what? God created this whole.
And God's story is playing out in the history of the world. Our question becomes, what am I doing? How does my story fit with inside God's story? Because it's only in as much as I know that, and I'm going to be able to make sense out of my own life. Okay? So, of course, we have tried everything we possibly can do to act like there is no God. In fact, we tell ourselves things like, you know, if there is no God, then I'd be free. You know, your whole religious thing, your whole God thing, it just puts rules and structure on me, it's trying to control me. And by doing that and giving me all these rules and standards, that just enslaves me. And I want to be free. But for something to truly be free, it has to live according to its design. You can look at an eagle, right, and say, and an eagle is free. It's free to fly. But that's only as much as it lives according to its design. An eagle is not free if it never decides to jump out of the nest. Right? It was created for that. And what the scripture tells us is that we fit within God's story because God created us to serve Him. And to serve one another. To live for God. To live for His glory. Not our own. And when we start to take life into our own hands and live it for ourselves and for our own glory, you know what it does? It enslaves us. We actually become like the eagle who can fly, but never jumps out of the nest. And it's just a matter of time, right, before they're dead. They're going to be like a snake or something that gets into the nest and kills them. Until it actually lives according to its design. And the scripture says that you and I were created, designed by God, to live for Him. Now, part of the way that begins to unpack in the scripture is that in verse, you jump down to verse 26 in the book of Genesis, verse 26 in Genesis 1, he says, then God said, let us make man in our image, after our likeness. Many of you have heard it said that we're created in the image of God. This is where it comes from. Now, notice that what do we think of when we think of humans? If I were to say, well, what are humans? We kind of think, you know, humans are sinners, right? But notice it doesn't say, let us make man into sinners. It doesn't say that. Now, I'm not saying that humans, and myself included, didn't become sinners or weren't born in sin, and that's a whole different message. But that wasn't the first thing that God uttered over your life. You're going to be a sinner. He said, let us make man in our image, after our likeness. Now, what does that mean? In biblical times, to have something created, when it says to God's going to create us in His image, what He's doing is that He would make a lot more sense to people who were like in ancient Near East culture, that were surrounded by kings, that had their kingdoms. And what kings would do is they would carve statues of their own image. And that is the way the kings would bring glory to themselves. And they would put those statues all over their kingdom so that wherever people walked, they'd be reminded, oh yeah, he's king. Right? That's why we dig up all these ancient Egyptian statues. And whatnot, right? Because they didn't have social media, right? They didn't have newspapers or anything like that. That was the way to get the message out so that everybody who's walking around living in this kingdom is reminded over and over again that I'm king. And so when God says, let us make man in our image, in the image of God, that we are called to be, we were created, our purpose was to be representing God to the whole world.
Amen.
Reflecting His character and His nature so that it would bring Him glory over the entire world.
Amen.
All right? So, now of course, there's a huge difference when God actually says this in Genesis chapter 1, let us make man in our image. People who were reading that would go, yeah, we understand the whole image bearer thing. We get that because kings are doing that all over the place. Pharaoh does it. Pharaoh's got his statue everywhere. The king of Egypt, right? He was supposed to be this divine person. And that he was getting messages from God and living out that character to the world. But that isn't what God says in Genesis chapter 1. It actually doesn't say, well, there's just one king to represent. It's all peasants. Everybody. Not just the high class, but every class. Every human is to be representing me to the whole. I get that phone. I think the Lord will be calling him. Whoever it is persistent. So, So our purpose is to reflect his character represented, right? And through that, to help life flourish, okay? So essentially, we're sort of like mirrors facing the sun and bringing warmth, love, and character of God to a cold and dying world. In fact, when God originally creates the heavens and the earth,